Words of the host are not those of Christ, the question arises. Can we still say that Christ is carried about in procession, say on Corpus Christi, or that he is placed in the tabernacle? Do we not really eat his flesh and drink his blood? Yes, says St. Thomas, he is moved, eaten, and drunk, but not in his own proper dimensions. He is moved, eaten, and drunk in his Eucharistic mode of existence, insofar as his presence coincides with the palpable qualities or accidents of the bread and wine. He is not physically harmed by any violence done to the sacrament, because its qualities and dimensions are not properly his. Christ's presence in the Blessed Sacrament is therefore knowable only to the intellect which accepts the Word of God in faith. His presence may be called sacramental because the appearances of the bread and wine indicate where Christ's body and blood are present. They are signs or instruments of a reality that is present in them. The Eucharistic presence, real though it be, does not cancel out the absence of which Jesus spoke when he took leave of his disciples at the Last Supper. The Eucharist is a memorial of Christ's historic presence here on earth and a pledge of his return in glory when we shall be able to see him as he is. From what I have said, you can see that the presence of Christ in this sacrament is unique and mysterious. Ritual guides warn us not to inquire too closely because our minds can easily become confused in speaking about such an exalted mystery. It is better simply to accept the words of Christ, of Scripture, of the tradition, and of the Church's magisterium, all of which tell us what we need to know, that Christ is really, but invisibly, present in this sacrament. His presence is such that the bread and wine after the consecration are truly, really, and substantially his body and blood, but according to a mode of existence that differs from his presence in heaven. Let me turn now to the minimizing errors. The Council of Trent is sometimes attacked on the ground that it focused too narrowly on one of the ways Christ is present in the liturgy. According to Paul VI and the Second Vatican Council, these authors remind us Christ is present in the liturgy in no less than five ways. In the congregation, when it gathers for prayer or song, in the Word of God, when it is proclaimed, in the priests, when they preside at the liturgy, in the sacraments, when they are administered, and finally, in the host and chalice offered at Mass. Presence in the consecrated elements, these authors maintain, is only one of the five and should not be taken as if it alone were real. In fact, they say, it should be seen as subordinate to the presence in the church, of which it is a sacramental sign. Did not St. Augustine and St. Thomas Aquinas teach us that the purpose of the sacrament is to bring about the unity of the Church as Christ's mystical body? Some theologians, therefore, began to say that Christ's primary presence is in the gathered assembly. According to the teaching of the church, the multiple presences of Christ are real and important, but the presence in the Eucharist surpasses all the others. Some 15 years before Vatican II, Pope Pius XII called attention to four of the ways in which Christ is present in the Eucharist, in the liturgy. But he was careful to point out that these presences are not all on the same level. The divine founder of the church, he wrote, is present above all in the Eucharistic species. Paul VI, in his encyclical of 1965, Mysterium Fidei, gave a similar listing, adding to Pius XII's list a fifth, Christ's presence in the proclamation of the word. But he left no doubt about which presence is primary. After noting the manifold presences of Christ, he declared, there is another way, and indeed most remarkable, in which Christ is present in his church in the sacrament of the Eucharist, which is therefore, among the rest of the sacraments, the most pleasing in respect to devotion, the most noble in respect to understanding, and the holiest in regard to what it contains. For it contains Christ himself and is, as it were, the perfection of the spiritual life and the goal of all the sacraments. This presence, he said, is called real, not because the others are unreal, but because it is real par excellence. As a substantial presence of the whole and complete Christ, the Eucharist surpasses his transitory and virtual presence in the waters of baptism, in the other sacraments, and in the proclamation of the word, and in the minister who represents Christ in these actions. As if this were not authority enough, one could note that Vatican II, in its constitution on the liturgy, said that Christ is present especially, maxime, under the Eucharistic species. And Pope John Paul II, in his 2003 encyclical on the Eucharist, says that we should be able to recognize Christ in his many forms of presence, but above all, in the living sacrament of his body and blood. There's a vast difference between Christ's presence in the Eucharist and in the assembly or its members. The worshipers, if they have the proper dispositions, are mystically united to God by grace. The Holy Spirit dwells in them, but they retain their own personal identity. They are not transubstantiated. They do not cease to be themselves and turn into Christ the Lord. The church's mystical body can never rise to the dignity of Christ in his individual body, which was born of the Virgin Mary, died on the cross, and is gloriously reigning in heaven. That body is present substantially in the Eucharist, but not in the Christian community. There's a vast difference between the adoration we give to Christ in the Eucharist and the veneration we offer to the saints. Some of these minimizing theologians argue that because the purpose of the Eucharist is to form the church